Well, good afternoon. As you know, we've been doing a study on death, dying, grieving, and the encouragement that we find in the Lord in times such as those. And I want us to return to that study next week. But this week, our attention, beginning on Thursday, is going to turn towards Mother's Day. Today, we are going to do something a little different and look at a topic that has come up in our cultural, kind of a cultural phenomenon that I want us to address, considering what is taking place, what the needs are that are being revealed, and how Christians ought to respond. Today, I'm going to be sharing from a New York Times article that was written by Cecilia Kang, and it is called "The Humble Phone Call Has Made a Comeback." So we're going to look at why that is, what that means for us as Christians. Make no doubt about it, that is a cultural phenomenon, the fact that phone calls, the frequency of them and the duration of them has increased significantly. Let's consider that. But before we do, I'm going to share two passages of Scripture. The first will be Psalm chapter 30, which I will read in its entirety, and then just an excerpt from Ephesians chapter 4. It says, "I will exalt you, Lord, for you lifted me out of the depths and did not let my enemies gloat over me. Lord, my God, I called to you for help and you healed me. You, Lord, brought me up from the realm of the dead. You spared me from going down to the pit. Sing the praises of the Lord, you, his faithful people. Praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may stay for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. When I felt secure, I said, I will never be shaken. Lord, when you favored me, you made my royal mountain stand firm. But when you hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, Lord, I called. To the Lord, I cried for mercy. What is gained if I am silenced? If I go down to the pit, will the dust praise you? Will it proclaim your faithfulness? Hear, Lord, and be merciful to me. Lord, be my help. You turn my wailing into dancing. You remove my sackcloth and clothe me with joy, that my heart may sing your praises and not be silent. Lord, my God, I will praise you forever." We find the psalmist here burst forth in a song during the dedication of the temple. And what he is saying here is, Lord, there have been times when I have been in distress. There have been times where I felt distant from you, when I felt as though I could no longer see your goodness in the land of the living, and I became discouraged. I cried out in those moments for help, and you heard my cry, and you responded, so much so, Lord, that you have ministered unto me and allowed me to be used as an instrument to bring you glory. And so he sings this at the dedication of the temple, and it's just a beautiful psalm. And I want to make sure that we are recognizing that today and considering what that means, to be in need and to cry out to God, to need only God's assistance in our times of greatest trial. We recognize that as we need God's assistance, so also do we need the assistance of others. That so often he hears our prayer and he responds. But how does he respond? He responds by sending other people as his representatives, as those who love him and love us because they love him, to come and minister to us, to encourage us in our seasons of distress. Ephesians chapter 4 shares this very principle. It says, "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." What we found in Psalm 30 was the way that God answers prayer. We found that he is not distant, that he is near, that he hears our prayers, that though we go through seasons of difficulty, though weeping may last for a night, joy comes in the morning. God's promises never fail. God's presence never leaves. God is actively working in your life and he is nearby. He recognizes what your needs are and he is able to meet those. In the same way, Ephesians here tells us that we need to follow the standard that God has set, that we need to make sure that there is nothing in our sinful hearts that hinders us from ministering to others, that we don't have bitterness or rage or anger or any of those things that are keeping us from recognizing the needs of others and reaching out to them and ministering to them. In fact, we ought to be encouraging them, building them up, that they might grow in the faith. Now, as I said today, as we consider what it means to minister to people in our world, we recognize that there are an increasing number of people right now that are in stress, that are depressed, that are anxious, that are fearful. There are a number of people who are battling health ailments. And so we recognize these challenges in our world, and as Christians, we need to be ready to respond. Let's turn our attention back to this idea of the phone call. We're going to work our way back to this. What in the world does the humble phone call have to do with this topic of encouraging other people, of ministering to them, loving them as God loves them, and building them up? Well, I want us to understand that in our day, there are obvious needs. There are obvious needs. And we find that the increase of telephone calls is a symptom of those needs. And let me share directly from this article. It says, Verizon said that it is now handling an average of 800 million wireless calls a day during the week, more than double the number made on Mother's Day, historically one of the busiest call days of the year. Verizon added that the length of voice calls was up 33% from an average day before the outbreak. AT&T said that the number of cellular calls had risen 35% and that Wi-Fi-based calls had nearly doubled from averages in normal time. We recognize that people are calling each other more frequently than ever before. I'm going to be very honest with you. Before the pandemic, I almost never used my cell phone to make calls. Almost never. That call feature was almost a side reality of a telephone. I receive a lot of emails throughout the day. I receive a lot of text messages, other forms of communication, Facebook Messenger. Many of you reach out to me in these various ways, and now I use my phone for Zoom. And so I have always used my phone for things like that. In fact, nobody really calls me. Very few people actually call me. Historically, I have visited a lot of people. So I'm not a good card sender, unfortunately. There's a lot in our community who are. I'm somebody who comes and visits you face to face. It's what I love to do. I also don't get a lot of voice messages. In my home, there's one member of our congregation who leaves voice messages, and then my grandmother used to. And now my grandmother has died. And so I know if I come in the door and there's a number blinking, it is the same person every time, because nobody else calls my house and leaves messages on my cell phone. I don't know the last time that one of my friends, for instance, called and left a voice message ever. I have three voice messages that are saved. They were all from my grandmother on my phone, and I've saved them and I listen to them from time to time, and they encourage me. But I don't use my phone for calling, and I'm not alone in that. There's a lot of people. But through the pandemic, I have found that I have been on it more often than ever. I have had a lot of calls. In fact, today I talked to a number of church members, and I talked to one member of our congregation for over half an hour. That probably made up the total time before that I spent on the phone for a week. And so that one call, but that's the reality, and it's a necessity of the days. Well, where am I going with this? Why is there an increase in phone calls? Is it just a convenience thing? You know, now because of work, people can't be around people, so they're making calls. Well, that certainly is part of it. But listen to what this writer said. She said, this journalist, new needs are emerging in the crisis. We've become a nation that calls like never before, said a woman named Jessica, a commissioner at the, I'm not going to try to pronounce her last name, a commissioner at the Federal Communications Commission, the agency that oversees phone, television, and internet providers. And I really want to make sure you don't miss this next line. We are craving human voice. We are craving human voice. Right now, as we cannot be in fellowship with one another physically, we can't sit across from somebody and drink a cup of coffee or visit with people. I'm not going to houses, even hospitals, nursing homes. Right now, I feel that a lot. It wears me down. I trust it wears you down. It is really difficult. And you have family members, perhaps you've not seen, grandparents or grandchildren. You have parents, you have siblings that you're not able to be around. And right now, we crave that sort of fellowship. We recognize that our relationships continue on, and they can be pretty deep, but there's something missing when we're not able to gather together. That's true in our interpersonal relationships. It is true as well in our church. If we do not gather together soon, it will begin to affect us spiritually. I said that the very first week. The Lord has called us to assemble together. Christians throughout church history have risked imprisonment because they recognize the value, the necessity of meeting together. We need to use our spiritual gifts to edify each other. That's what we need to do. And so we're getting close to that point. But we recognize that when we cannot gather together, then when people are isolated in their houses, not just because they can't connect with other people, but that's part of it, mental health issues abound. Right now, as people are not able to be out as often or around other people, even just out in the sun and smelling the warm breeze, and I say that because we live in the country. I would not say that if we lived in the city, because there might not be such a thing. But people are battling anxiety and depression, perhaps like they never have before. I shared weeks ago that suicide hotlines were being overwhelmed with phone calls. There are people who have new financial concerns that they've never had before. Small business owners, those who have been received unemployment or are waiting for unemployment to come in. People who are having these kind of stresses, marital strains, we are seeing pop up. There's a lot of reports of marriages that are in crisis, of new challenges that come up. We need, as Christians, to recognize that there are obvious needs right now, that people have the need to interact with other people. And we see that expressed in the uptick of phone calls each day. Now, I want to note something about, and that's really my first point, if we're going off points today, there are obvious needs right now. And if you stop and think about it, if you watch headlines, you know what those needs are. But the second point would be that recognizing needs has been more challenging now than ever before. To be very honest, as a pastor, there are some things that we recognize that we cannot see. I understand that there are probably many people in our congregation that battle things that I am unaware of at all points. But there are obvious signs when somebody is in distress. When I'm preaching and I look out and somebody is really clinging to something and you can see that they're emotionally stirred, there's usually a reason for that. People reach out to me after services and want to pray with me or talk to me. The very last sermon that I preached here, I had a man who came and shared some things with me as a result of the sermon and wanted me to pray with him. Those things happen, so there's an immediate reaction. Somebody responds in person. I get to see what's going on. I read faces a little bit while I'm preaching. When I'm connecting with somebody, and I know that it's really difficult to get deep with people on Sunday mornings, I shake hands, how are you? And everybody says, okay. But sometimes, just sometimes, somebody will say, not so well. And that'll set up a future conversation. I'll follow up and usually visit with them. The biggest telltale sign is that somebody who's a faithful church member stops coming. And so I look out and I see that you're not sitting in your designated pew. And I know as Christians, we tend to sit in the same seats Sunday after Sunday. And so I look out and somebody's not there. Now, the alarm bell doesn't go off after 1 week. Sometimes, depending on how frequently you come to church, not after 2 weeks. But a few weeks pass and I haven't seen somebody, for me, that sets off huge red flags. And I follow up by reaching out with people and asking, how are you? When we see people constantly, we know what's going on in their lives. We have an idea. We see that even their tone changes sometimes. They don't have to say something's wrong. You pick it up in their tone or their body language, the way that they respond to sermons. We see based on whether or not they are absent or they are present or whether they are involved or whether they say, I'm done serving. I don't want to serve. We see that there's something wrong going on. There's a difficulty. And so we can address those. right now, it is harder than ever to recognize needs because we do not see people in person. If we just stick to things like text messaging, well, there's no emotional connection. Emails. In emails, I try to be as black and white, as dry as possible, because people read into emotions that often aren't there. It's, you know, but that's the reality, because those forms of communication are not meant to really relay any form of emotion whatsoever. So if you're just following along through email, through text messaging, through Messenger, whatever platform you use to have conversations with the people, you will not know that somebody is having a hard time. If you pick up the phone and call somebody, though, there's at least a chance that you will get more out of what they're going through. You will be more aware, because you'll hear tone, you'll hear emotion, you'll hear pauses that really relay a lot sometimes, even sometimes more than words. And so as Christians, we need to recognize that we cannot be lazy right now. We cannot be lazy and just assume that we're going to know what somebody's going through. Instead, the third point, we need to be intentional in our ministry. Right now, we need to be intentional about ministering to other people. What's interesting is that this New York Times article, which is by no means a Christian article, and they do not, I believe, generally try to write to a Christian audience predominantly, as a secular newspaper, they said something interesting about a Roman Catholic church. But they said this: though phone calls are now made over airwaves that connect through cell phone towers, the appeal of talking hasn't changed much from the earliest telephone days of the late 1800s to the early 1900s, when wooden poles stretched copper wire lines across the nation and into every home across America. In Albany, Louisiana, the priests and deacons of St. Margaret Queen of Scotland Church recently divided up a list of 900 parishioners to call to check in on them, something they never did because they saw their members in a person. Some of the congregants in the rural community outside of New Orleans were suspicious when they answered, accustomed to robocalls from unfamiliar numbers. But Brad Doyle, the associate priest, said they eased up when they began to speak. They talked about their daily routines and said they missed Sunday service, especially ahead of Easter. Many just wanted to hear a prayer, he said. What's interesting there is we have this Roman Catholic Church that recognizes that there are needs right now. And so they are being intentional about saying, you know, we're not going to know what somebody's going through because we don't see them. We're not going to know by connecting with them over text, email, whatever it might be, these mass forms of communication that we use. We need to actually call somebody. They need to have human interaction. They need to hear a human voice. That is what people crave right now. As a Christian right now, we want to model what God is like. God is not distant. We cannot be distant. God recognizes needs. We need to recognize needs. God responds to those needs. We need to respond to those needs. God has called us to edify, to encourage one another. We need to be doing that. That's the character of God that we expressed in Psalm 30. That is the commands. Those are the commands that we find in Ephesians chapter 4. Right now, there are needs that are obvious. The way to address those is very narrow. We have a very narrow way to minister to people right now, but it can be very effective. Can I challenge you today? Would you go through our church directory, and I forgot that word. Would you go through the church directory? Would you find people that you have not connected with in a couple weeks, people that you know are going through hard times, or maybe you have no idea? Maybe somebody you're close to, maybe somebody you're not. Would you call two or three people? That's all I'm asking you to do. Over the course of the next few days, would you reach out to them? Would you ask them how they're doing? Would you talk to them about everything that's going on? Just, you know, it depends on the relationship with you have. Get as deep as you'd like. But then would you ask, can I pray for you? It's just such a simple request, but I've never been denied when I've asked people, can I pray for you? And then pray with them over the phone. Don't say, I'll pray with you later. Pray with them right then. It would be amazing. You'd be amazed to know what kind of encouragement that will bring to people right now. I pray that the Lord is encouraging you. As always, I'm here for you. If you would like to connect with me in any way, I'm doing my best to call as many members in our church as I can in these times and to stay connected with you. please feel free to connect with me. May God bless you.